So, and I think they'll come out because people are signing who have registered who can't attend live will be able to hear your beautiful questions and, of course, the amazing Gordon Emerson of Resource Therapy International. So that's so amazing. We're super excited because this is part of the Resource Therapy Institute online series and seminars. I hope to continue this ongoingly. It's been amazing. Has anyone been here on previous seminars? As or we're all new. Unmute yourself if you have. Okay. And this is my first meeting because the ones I've done before are webinars, so it's great to be able to have people, but please be so yeah, let's look. Sometimes the chat. Okay. I won't just write in the chat. And and it's great to see you again, Mandy. How are you doing?
I'm great, thank you. I'm trying to get the glow of the moon out
On
from the back of my head.
the back of you've got a halo. That's nice. I find a lot of therapists do. That's great. That's great. So I'll just give another like 5 minutes for people and then we'll kick off. We've had over nearly 90 people register for this online seminar, which is super amazing. Amazing. Oh, thank you, Donna. Just a beautiful shout out there. Happy Mother's Day out there to all the mothers of both people and our furry friends. And we're all here to, yeah, and those substitute mothers. Thank you, Donna. It's beautiful. Yeah. Who's got their furry friends here with them, actually? Anyone, yeah, can we see them?
Mittens, kitty. Oh, let me mute my button.
Oh yeah, I have to. Yeah, if I had Yoda in here, he'd be like running around and jumping and probably leave the meeting. Beautiful. Chris has been very kind. I haven't spoken to my daughter yet. I think it's a bit early. She's in Victoria, but I've already had. Oh, look at Kitty. Who's it's in? I'll unmute you, Cindy. What's your okay.
Oh, his name is Zeus. He's a very smart. He turned on my radio this morning at 4 in the morning. He opens doors like both ways. He's like having a troublesome child. He's really he opens containers. He's funny. He's a funny look at.
So you, Zeus, the god of he's
My
amazing.
son named him very well, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, your son, huh? He's beautiful, beautiful. Any other kitties? Hi, Judith. I can see you sitting in your beautiful therapy chair. I just feel relaxed seeing you, Judith. I'm like, I want to have therapy with you right now. Great. And I think Gordon's helping me admit people. He's my co-host here. And welcome, welcome to Dorothy. Oh, Dorothy, you've got to see Mandy's picture. You need that with your last name, Dorothy Moon. Hi, Leanne, are you in bed there? That's beautiful. Are you okay? I love it. Snuggling up. That's so nice. Is it cold where you are, Leanne? I'm after Leanne D. Donald, sorry, because there's a couple of Leannes. I know Leanne's having brunch. Can I unmute you? I will unmute. I'm having trouble. So, oh, hi.
Yeah, I'm in Ballarat in Victoria.
Oh, a hop, skip, and a jump, probably from where Gordon and Anna are. So it's pretty cold there.
Yeah.
I love it that, yeah, this is great with
Well, I'm in
the.
my camper van, so.
Oh,
Oh, wow. So have you escaped from the city for a little bit? It's. Leanne? D? Yeah. Okay, yeah. So, and we're welcoming a couple more people. So we have 17 people on the call so far. And in 2 more minutes, we'll start about 19. And I have to have a special shout out. Hi, Heather. Hi, Yvette. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Sandra, welcome. If I catch anyone, please type your name and say good day in the chats and just tell us where you're from. And if there's clinical resource therapists who are, or what's your professional background? I had hoped to have a poll, but actually polls don't happen on Zoom. So, because our last webinar we had, we were able to ask what profession you are. So please let us know. Catherine, you're from Sydney. Welcome. Lovely to see you. Can I see you on my screen? You want to give us a shout out? Because that's how we, resource therapist. Oh, I see you. Thanks, Catherine. Lovely. And it's a good idea if you can have light facing on from you too sometimes. Because Mandy, you know, like you're in the dark side of the moon. That can help us see your face. But if you want. I'm like, okay, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. I don't usually wear makeup and put lipstick on, but you know, for you guys. Okay, and welcome, Yvette. Lovely to hear from you. Do you want to say good day? I think you're unmuted. I can't even see your mute button, no video. Feel free to make your comfort how you want to do that. Mandy's a clinical hypnotherapist all the way from Harvey Bay. I love this, isn't it? It's great, Gordon. We are meeting
fantastic.
All over the world. All over the world. Shame, yeah. And so fantastic. Isn't it incredible? So, yeah. And there's a whole lot of things happening in the resource therapy world. We're going to show you some of those things here today, as well as for some of you, this might be exciting to see Gordon. Some of you have probably trained with other trainers. I know Judith has trained with me. I know Catherine's trained with Tracy. And yeah, and Donna, yeah, you've done lots of training. And Shane. Shane was on the Bridging Mastery Series. That was good. And Mandy too. That was fantastic. It was great knowing that we can do training online. And this is a huge opportunity for resource therapy. It's becoming more widespread in so many other countries, but this makes it so much easier to access in terms of training. Yeah, so exciting. Oh, and I wanted a special say hi from our Kiwi contingent. I know Faye, and I'm talking Faye Luand. If there's another person, yay, hi Faye, lovely. Oh, that's really good too. If we want to ask a question, to wave out. And oh, guys, and I'm going to actually unspot my, cancel the spotlight. Sorry, I'm still getting used to all this technology. But Faye, do you want to say a quick hi from my beautiful home country?
Yay! Hi, you guys. Good morning. There's a couple of us, though, here. I'm not the only Kiwi here. I think, isn't Leanne on here as well?
Is that Leanne Little? Who is?
Yeah, Leanne Little. Yeah, I see her name here. Leanne, don't be shy. Don't leave me on the spot alone.
She was having brunch. So Leanne, you can unmute yourself if you want and just say a quick hi without showing us, well, what's for breakfast? Kiwi food is really good. What was that, Leanne?
The internet connection is not great. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous day here. Beautiful. I hope it's gorgeous wherever you guys are. And we're really looking forward to this.
Yeah, fantastic, because we know we want to come and do training in New Zealand, and this is fantastic. What part of New Zealand are you from?
We're in Auckland.
Okay, I'm originally from Thames, so.
Oh, right.
No, yeah, neighbours.
Far, literally around the corner.
Yeah, really. Yeah, only an hour and a half from the airport. That'd be fantastic. So I think Auckland might be, or Wellington. Actually, we were discussing this, weren't we, Gordon?
Come to Auckland, please. We don't want to.
Well, if there's enough interest, we'll come wherever you want. But we were thinking maybe even Wellington, just to meet in the middle.
Yeah.
For our South Island fellows as well. Over there. Hi, Chloe. Yeah. Thanks, Faye. Beautiful.
Nice to meet you guys. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, this is so great. New people around the world. Cindy's been on my calls a couple of times. It's so great. And does anyone, just introduce yourself. Chloe, I can see you. Do you want to say a quick hi?
Hello, I'm ringing in from Sydney.
Okay, beautiful. So am I. What part of Sydney, Chloe?
Up at Pittwater.
Oh, nice. See, it's so distant. That's about an hour from where I am. So just the tyranny of distance is lost.
Yeah.
Here in each other's beautiful, I'm in my office, people in bed, people around the kitchen table, and that's fantastic. And anyone else want to say a quick hi before I kick off? And Gordon's actually going to help me. He's going to let people in for me.
I may or may not. I don't know. I'm not. It's not okay.
Okay. Well, I can, and it seems to be there. So we now have almost 20 people on the call. Isn't that amazing? Just from all over the globe. So there's a couple of things for meeting etiquette. I love that everyone's, thank you for having the mute button on. Oh, that's handy. And we will come to questions and that. And yes, Leanne's saying she's a clinical hypnotherapist and meditation teacher from New Zealand. That's great. Pop in the chat where you're from and stuff, and we'll get to you too. Let me just show you some really exciting things. Resource therapy is developing rapidly and spreading like a beautiful thing, like a flower that it is. Let me share my screen there with you. So there's a couple of things I want to show you here. It's always good to take that. So on this call, so I've got another seminar coming up, the Intergenerational Bridging Program, Leaving the Legacy of Trauma. So if you wanted to sign up for that, it's May 25th. That's on resourcetherapy.com.au. That's resourcetherapy.com.au. That is for clinical resource therapists or those who have advanced training in a type of modality like EMDR or clinical hypnotherapists. You'll need to register your interest with me because that's a level of clinical ability required for that. Let me move this around. But very exciting, tomorrow is, we've run a foundation, but this is the clinical resource therapy online training. Enrollments are now open. This is Resource Therapy International website. And here is all the trainers, of course, that we're coming along. Myself and Chris is there. There's Kevin Peel. There's Dan. There's Shane. There's Donna. There's Anna Forey, Tracy, and Dr. Allison. There we all are. So that's a really unique series. And also running a clinical as well in a different format. I'm doing one day a week, I think, in the future. That's coming up. And that's on which I haven't told Anna about, but I will. And there's trainings all around the world. It's so amazing, isn't it? So
the clinical training gives you the training to practice and call yourself a resource therapist.
Yes, exactly. Oops, and I'm sharing my screen, but I don't want to be sharing that. Stop sharing that one. Yeah, so it's super exciting. So much happening there. And so let me introduce my beautiful guest speaker formally. Some of you may or may know the amazing Gordon. He is a PhD and an honorary fellow in the School of Psychology at Victoria University, Melbourne, where he's taught and coordinated many counselling and statistics programs for over 18 years. Professor Emerson has been a member of the Clinical Board of Psychologists with the Australian Psychological Society. He was co-founder of the Australasian Ego State Therapy Association, ESTA, in 2011. And later that year, Professor Emerson assisted in the formation of Ego State Therapy International, ESTI, where he was the inaugural vice president. And in 2014, Professor Emerson introduced his distinct therapeutic resource therapy, which is a trauma-informed, attachment-aware, and strength-based parts model, resource therapy. And in the same year where he met the gorgeous, beautiful Anna Emerson, might not have been that year, I'm going to ask you later, Gordon, that they co-founded Resource Therapy International. And that's the peak governing body for resource therapy. And Gordon has conducted many writings and research that's been published in many journals. He's widely respected around the world. As well as having taught in university, his teaching program saw him traveling the world, where he's taught both in Australia, South Africa, Europe, New Zealand, the US, Indonesia, and Middle East. Gordon provides statistical and research training for the Australian Consortium of Social and Political Resource. I won't even go into that. And so he regularly teaches statistics as well. So it's a very handy element. And he's written numerous books on the subject of counselling, psychological therapies, and in particular, some wonderful books on resource therapy. The resource therapy book here, which I can't mirror. I know there's a way to mirror that, but I haven't. The primer, ego state therapy, and and also a book on how to publish your research. Man of many talents. So thank you, Gordon, for joining us. I'm going to not spotlight myself. I'm going to change the view. So let's spotlight, cancel, let's spotlight you. And there you go. So you're now, yeah, so you are, we're very privileged to have you here. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Welcome to Blackwood, Victoria.
Oh, and what's the temperature in Blackwood, Victoria?
It was 2 degrees when we got up this morning. I'm not sure what it is now.
Okay. But you're looking really comfortable. Is the fire on or?
Oh, we have central heating. We cheat a bit.
Yeah, you need to. Fantastic. And, oh, look at that. Someone's calling. They're dialing in right now. So thanks. Anna's gotten that. I know Anna's in the background there, and I'll say a quick hi a bit later.
I think it's my kids calling to say Happy Mother's Day.
Oh, isn't it? Oh, hang on. Thank you, Anna. And isn't that nice? So feel free to go and answer any Mother's Day calls or calls you have. Fantastic. And so it's so fantastic to have you here today. And to paraphrase, can I just get you to turn that off before I ask? I have this brilliant question planned. Hang on, wait. So, you know, it's wonderful to have you here. And to paraphrase a fantastic therapeutic question of yours, which you formulated for Resource Therapy, I'd like to ask you, Gordon, what is it you're ready to tell us today?
What am I ready to tell you today? Yeah, what Philip is talking about, I like the question when a client comes in, what are you ready to change today? And to me, that when they answer that question, they're contracting for how much movement they want and exactly what they're ready to change. And it makes life easier for the therapist. So what am I ready to tell you today? I'm ready to tell you I'm really happy that there's this interest in resource therapy, and hopefully everyone can get more clarity on what it has to offer, and more excited about helping clients, because that's sort of my mission, to move this from myself, where it landed in some way, to other people, because I've seen such really good changes with clients.
Mm. So let me ask you a few questions on that. I mean, and getting to know you, the person. So we're in Australia, but I'm hearing that's not an Australian accent. Where were you born and raised, Gordon?
I was raised in the US. I came to Australia when I was 21. I moved here in the 70s, and I've lived here most of my life. Well, I went back to the States for some more education. And and I've always been around Melbourne somewhere. Blackwood, where Anna and I live now, is about an hour from Melbourne in the Murdur Mountains.
Mm. It's a beautiful area. And that's where I first did the training, and back in Blackwood there. Beautiful. And so you did some, where was your first level? Where did you first do psychology? Was psychology your first choice, or counseling your first choice, or? In training
back then? Yeah, the first year I came to Australia when I was 21, I taught high school. Oh. And I had, my degree was in social sciences, which psychology is something I could teach. Mm-hmm. And I found, I enjoyed talking to students, and students talked to me about their problems and things like that, issues just naturally. Mm-hmm. And so I decided to go back and get my master's and PhD in clinical psychology. So that's what I did. And I finished that with a 1 year APA internship in Missoula, or in Bozeman, Montana, a postdoc internship.
Ah, in those days. And curiously, this is a question from Chris, so this makes more sense. Chris has sort of said when he was training in his clinical psychology back then, you know, there's major inferences of behaviorism in the theory with B.F. Skinner and Watson, that, you know, and so that was influential in academic psychology. How much influence did it have on you, and how did you become interested in really counseling an ego state?
Well, cognitive behavioralism is the flavor of the month for the past several years. Most therapists in the world are cognitive behavioral. And most institutions have, you know, they train in CBT. When my PhD supervisor asked me what I was wanting to do my thesis in, he said to pick something that I found interesting, and I had recently learned hypnotherapy. Mm-hmm. And so I did my PhD thesis on hypnosis, and that got me a little bit deeper than cognitive behavioral goes. Cognitive behavioral will look at the past in terms of where a problem started, but the techniques are more today. You don't tend to go into the past to help someone. Some of the other therapies, you revisit times of trauma or change in the past to help someone today. That tends not to be what the CBT therapists do.
No.
And so I moved more into therapies that went to the cause rather than the symptoms.
Mm-hmm. And yes. And so that's where you've got your kind of start in hypnosis and became interested in that. So how did that evolve from hypnosis, ego state, to resource therapy? And I'll ask, yeah.
You know, I had taught at university, I'd taught therapy for several years, a range of therapies, psychodynamic therapies, cognitive behavioral therapies, phenomenological therapies, and I was going to do a sabbatical, and the sabbatical was going to be on pain and the psychological aspects of pain. And in reviewing the literature for that, I found an article by John and Helen Watkins, Dissociation and Displacement, Where Goes the Ouch, which sounded really interesting to me. And Watkins was talking about how when someone is hypnotized, they can experience a pain in one state, but not in another state. And I found that fascinating. And that got me started on parts therapies, and my sabbatical research was on ego state therapy and pain, and I wrote that up in an article. It was in Watkins' first book, and then later on I evolved on away from Watkins' work to resource therapy.
Yes. So, well, that was going to be one of my questions. Who were your mentors? I guess Watkins was. Any other influences and mentors in your professional life journey there, or personal life journey? Yeah.
Oh, I've had, you know, trainers. I had a really good trainer when I was in university in helping me pick up things that the client was experiencing and reflect that back to the client, a form of active listening. Watkins, both John and Helen, I spent a summer with them at one time, were great mentors. In terms of the life in general, I love Nelson Mandela and Martin Luther King and Gandhi. And, you know, there's some amazing people that sort of transcend above the normal individual to give us all inspiration, I think.
Yeah, spiritual kind of leaders of our time, speaking of peace and freedom. And that. So you're a little bit unclear. There's a little bit of something happening with your speakers. So I just want to check your connection. But it's not bad. It's not major. You may not hear that. So, and I know for many years you taught hypnosis and ego state therapy. And what was it that led you to go on to develop resource therapy, Gordon?
When I started working with parts and bringing parts out and talking with them, I was fascinated by the personality. It's very dynamic. But some of the ways that Watkins had seen parts, I just wasn't seeing that. Mm-hmm. For example, he thought that introjects are like the mother, the father become ego states. And I'll give you an example. If we bring out a child part, if we regress someone through a bridging technique to a child part, that child can talk about their mother being there or their father being there. And the way I see that mother or that father is they're an introject. They are an internalized impression of somebody else held by that child part, that state of the client. But the mother, the father is not an introject. Just as if I go to the post office and the postman comes out and I talk to the postman and I come back and somebody asks me about that experience, when I talk about that postman, that's not a part of me, that's an internalized impression. So this is a real key difference between ego state therapy and resource therapy. Mm. A lot of ego state therapists believe that the inner mother, the inner father, and other people are actually ego states, and they work with them to try to change them. And in resource therapy, we don't do that. We work with the part itself. Anytime we bridge to a part, anytime we go from one part of the personality to another, well, we always go to a resource state. We never go to an interject. That's not part of the person. That's an impression that part holds of somebody else. And one of the powerful things about resource therapy is that it's much more powerful to empower the part of the person and give that part of the person an understanding that they're safe and loved and appreciated than it is to try to work with their impression of somebody else and change that impression and thereby change the part. The number of sessions it takes is far fewer. And I think it's not congruent to the client if they had an abusive father to change that abusive father into a nice father. The person knows their father is abusive, and it's much more empowering to make sure that child understands this is a memory now. I can clear my space of that abuse. I can have loving things in my space, and that part can walk away feeling safe and secure and appreciated.
Yeah, sorry, I'm having a little side check there because we've actually had a question. It's Shane's answered it, but maybe this is a good time to kind of go in. Someone's asked, what's an introject? Mm-hmm. And maybe this is a good time to go into what's resource therapy, and share with us the delights that I know is, and we want to inspire you. And yeah. Do you want
Can I share something on screen here?
Yes, you are co-host, so you can share that.
Okay,
so.
Let me. I will see if I can do this.
That's right. Sorry, Shane, I misspelled your name. So this is going to tell you a lot more on me.
This is the way I see the personality. We have a conscious part, the ego state therapist, we call it an executive part, but one part can be in the conscious at any time. And this part that is in the conscious is the one that experiences things, it's the one that could be traumatized, it's the one that makes the final decision on things. But at the same time, we have different parts of the personality, and some of those parts are surface. Let me see if I'm spotlighting here. These parts here are what I call surface parts. Now, all of our parts can change their position, but often we generally have the same parts that are surface or conscious, and occasionally one will come from an underlying position. These are underlying parts. So we've got underlying parts, surface parts, and conscious parts. So if I'm going to buy a car, I will go in my conscious part, and one surface part might say, I really like the blue one. And another surface part will say, don't forget the bank account. And my underlying parts don't know what's going on. They're subconscious now. So the surface parts are observing and advising. And so this conscious part is experiencing, making decisions, and the surface parts will have memories afterward, but the underlying parts are dissociated. If a part moves from underlying directly into the conscious, then the person will not have memories of what was just happening. They may realize, I just read two paragraphs and I don't have a clue what I just read, or I just drove 15 kilometers or miles down the road and I don't have a clue, I don't remember driving. Mm-hmm. So they don't have a clue because the part of them that's now in the conscious came from an underlying position. And for DID, dissociative identity disorder, multiple personality, people tend to have fewer surface parts, and sometimes one underlying part will move into the conscious and that part that was in the conscious moves directly into the underlying. And the person may have no memory of what was happening for some period of time. Now, you ask about introjects. An introject is an internalized impression. So this part that's in the conscious will have an internalized impression of the people that that part has known and met and experienced. It will have an internalized impression of the fire, of the dog. But, you know, it's not just people. Most of those internalized impressions can be quite positive. Some of them can be negative. And if this part has an internalized impression of something it fears greatly, and it comes back into the conscious, it will come into the conscious with that fear. If this part has an internalized impression of being neglected or unloved, and it comes into the conscious, it will come into the conscious with the internalized impression of someone who didn't love them, and they will carry that emotion. So this is what I view, the way I view an introject. It's just an internalized impression. It's not a resource state. It's not an ego state. It's just the impression that one state holds. A child state will have one internalized impression about mother. An adult state would have its own different internalized impression about mother. So these introjects are state dependent. Each state has its own internalized impressions.
Can I just sort of say, like, too, with an introject, it's like a memory fragment. It's like a cartoon. It's not real. That's kind of key concept there, isn't it?
That's right. And if we bridge to a trauma, you can say to the state, it's important to have the state that was at the trauma in the conscious, but we can say to that state, now this isn't happening. So now you can say to that person whatever you want because they don't exist. They're not really here. It's just a memory fragment. That's very different than ego state therapy, where they will often have the person fight with the introject. They will have them hit pillows or Watkins used to have them yelling and screaming at the introject and sometimes cutting them up in their own imagination. And to me, that's not as empowering as just saying, they're not here, they don't exist, let's shrink them down to 1 inch tall, you can say anything you want. So we're empowering the state that was previously traumatized, so it no longer holds that trauma, no longer has that. Now, what hypnosis is when most of these states have sunk beneath the surface, and it's mainly one, if it's somnambulistic hypnosis, it's only one, but usually one a conscious state and maybe one or two surface states that are observing. But the focus is so strong that most of those states have gone under the surface. And sometimes, in addiction, that happens where there's a state that assumes the conscious And it's able to push the other states under the surface where they're not asking questions about, should you be eating that or should you be gambling right now? When an addictive state, what I call a retro-avoiding state, is in the conscious, it's so powerful it can push other surface states under the surface, making them underlying so that that addiction can continue. And it's doing it for a good reason, but that's what's happening.
That's a key part of resource therapy, isn't it? All our parts have a trying to benefit, help, good intention. However, isn't that right, Gordon?
That's right. It's every part is doing something positive. So if there's an addicted part, a part that's doing something we don't want it to do, we find out how it's helping and we give it another tool to help in a way that's positive for the client. And we say, thank you for helping, as opposed to focusing on the negative behavior and criticizing it for that, which mm-hmm. keeps it from wanting to help.
Yeah, I love that strength-based approach. It's fantastic, isn't it? And it makes the clients feel more at ease within themselves and truly integrated, doesn't it? It's like, oh my gosh, every part of me is a useful part, a good part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if that answers the question or not, but I got went on a bit of a rant there. No,
that's okay. So any other questions? How is that settling in for some people? Will be aware of ego state or not at all? Some people will be have different schools of thought and training. I'd love to hear. What are your questions? Bring them on. So this is really important. Faye says, yes, it does. Thank you. That's great. More than. And anything else? So what about clinical? Yes, we've got it. Catherine, I'm going to come to you. Okay. So I'll cancel the spotlight. Are you okay? So I'm giving you a couple of seconds to just prepare yourself and find you. And I'll get you to answer your question live if you like. You don't. Yeah. So, there you go. I'll spotlight your video. Yep. Thanks, Catherine.
Thanks, Philip. Hello, Gordon. Lovely to meet you.
Hi,
I have a couple of clients. Thank you. I have a couple of clients that are French. I speak French, and I've just taken on a client who's Spanish. I'm actually dealing with her in France where she lives. Mm-hmm. And I had a session with her last night, so this is front of mind for me. When we got to the action of expression, she'd been vivifying and we bridged back and then we were into expression. And she said to me, oh, I'm thinking in Catalan, which is her mother tongue. Mm-hmm. And then she came into English. But I wondered afterwards, I thought maybe I should have let her express herself in her mother tongue and then give me an English version of that so that she was really dropping more deeply into her feeling, her authentic feeling. What have you had any experience with that, or can you give me any suggestions?
I've had clients sometimes say, I didn't know English at the time, or I couldn't speak, I was too young. And I will say, that's okay. Just allow this other state to lend you their voice so you can talk directly to me. And how and why that works, I don't know, but it works. And so one state can allow another state to have its voice so it can talk directly to you. And I find that fascinating. The brain is so dynamic, but that tends to work quite well for me.
Thank you.
And what Catherine was mentioning, expression, that's one of the actions. There's resource therapy has 15 actions. Mm. And for states that have been invaded with fear or rejection, states that have been overwhelmed with feelings of being physically afraid, or states that have been overwhelmed with a feeling of not being good enough, being abandoned, being rejected, there are four actions that we often use: expression, interject speak, removal, and relief. And when you do the resource therapy training, you learn how to bring those states to the surface. The real strength of resource therapy is to be able to get the state to the surface, to in the conscious, so you can talk directly with the state that has the problem. And then when you are talking with that state, and if you take that state to the ISE, the initial sensitizing event, there's those four actions: expression, interject, speak, removal, and relief, that moves that state from being overwhelmed with negative feelings to feeling safe and protected and loved. And it's a huge change for the client.
I call that the empowerment phase, where the resolution phase, because it's so empowering and you see that shift in front of you. It can be like 10 minutes. It's so tiny, yeah, isn't it? You visit the imaginal space, because we can change anything, and that state that's been invited, what I like to use is a ship metaphor, to invite that state out on deck to play with, I often say, and work with that state directly, which is a bit different too to a lot of other therapies, isn't it too? But the empowerment phase is amazing. Go.
It's so imperative that we're talking to the right state. A lot of clients will come to a therapist and they will be talking about their problem, and that's not the state with the problem. They're talking about another state of the problem. They're talking about a state that is gambling, and that state that's talking doesn't want to gamble. Or they're talking about a state that becomes emotional or feels bad about itself. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that's one of the bad things about a lot of therapies like CBT. They will continue to talk with that reporting state, and that's not the state that has the issue. That's not the state that needs to change. If you're talking to a student in a classroom and one student is telling you about another student with a problem, it doesn't help the student with a problem to continue to talk with the student that's telling about it. You've got to go to that student with a problem and work with that student directly. And in resource therapy, one of the first things we learn is how to bring any state we want to talk with into the surface, so we can talk with it directly and work with it one-on-one.
So, and Faye's saying, right, work with the part, with the issue, not the reporting state. Got it. It's so powerful, that, isn't it? Yeah.
That's right.
Can I ask you then, Gordon, too, I mean, if you see perhaps beginning resource therapists and parts therapists, what do you see as the struggles? And so, you know, and in making sure you've got the right part out, can you give us some ideas and reflections and suggestions there that might help people to understand when you've got the right part to be working with?
Yeah, I think it comes really naturally for some people, and some people it doesn't. I've seen some therapists that have gone through the training and they're still talking to the one part about another part, as opposed to going to that other part, talking with it directly. Mm-hmm. And this is a real difference in ego state theory and resource therapy theory. Ego state theory believes there's a core personality, and then there's splinter parts that are broken off of that core, and those are the states. And in resource therapy, we see the personality as being a mosaic. Hmm. I'm in one of my parts now, later on I'll be in another part, another time I'll be in another part, and all my parts together make up Gordon. And my parts in resource therapy, my parts came about through childhood learning. And if I did something, a type of activity over and over and over again, that activity became commonplace for that part. And if I need that learning, that part comes into my conscious and I use that part. And that's where our different resources come from. I call them resource states, not ego states. Mm. Ego states are called ego states because Paul Federn rightly noticed that when we change from one part to another, we take our ego with us. We always think this is me, no matter what part we're in. Mm. So we call them ego states, which is fair enough. But I think it's more descriptive, because they are our resources, to call them our resource states. They all developed for our own purpose, and we can use them all again for our own purpose. Mm. And I think it's more positive and more accurate to call them resource states.
It's fantastic, isn't it? Yeah, resource states, parts, states, resources, all are the same term we use interchangeably to denote the resource, the part that's in the conscious. So they all mean the same thing as well, state, resource, and
part. Whether they're in the conscious or not.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, so it's the same term meaning the same thing. So if we're talking about a part, we're talking about a resource, we're talking about a state, they're the same terms. Yeah. So can you tell us maybe a little bit how you came to develop, move a shift away from ego state, which is a great therapy, and how you came to come into developing resource therapy originally, Gordon, there?
Well, it probably helped me that I was a bit isolated. I was at the there were other people doing ego state therapy in Australia, but I'd never met them, and I learned about it through reading, and then I started developing my techniques separately from Watkins, and even my first book, Ego State Therapy, that has a lot in common with resource therapy. More so than Watkins' books, Ego State's Theory and Therapy.
I've got that. That one.
Yeah, that's Watkins' book. I first met Watkins because I had done some research, that sabbatical research, on ego states, and he called me and asked me about putting that in that book. And I was happy for him to, obviously, and got to know him, and then went over and spent a couple of months with him. But my concept of states and the way I, when I was talking to, from one state to another, I almost called that book Turning the Lights On, because it's like you get to see what's happening on the inside of the personality. I think that's an advantage to resource therapy over something like EMDR, where you may be making change, but you can't hear the voice of the part. You don't know exactly how much change you're making. You don't know exactly what emotion that state is in. With resource therapy, you can talk directly with the part. You can hear the voice. You can see exactly what it needs, and you can respond to that. Mm-hmm.
No, no. I was going to say, actually, it's funny you mention EMDR, and it's a great therapy like them. And that's how I came to learn resource therapy. Actually, was I trained in EMDR, and my trainer said, you need a parts therapy. Gordon Emerson's training ego state at the time. So I came along and did the ego state to become resource therapy, because actually, if you do advanced EMDR, you need a parts therapy like resource therapy in order to really enhance the work when you bridge and so forth. Gordon, it's a very powerful adjunct and many to fit into a therapeutic tool. Yeah. And the name resources, I like that too. Yeah.
I thought about that for a while. When I decided I needed to separate it from ego state therapy, because the differences were so fundamental. In ego state therapy, you've got a core personality, and an ego state is the trauma that's broken away from that core. And Watkins thought we only have three or four ego states. I think we've got 50 to 150 parts. And seeing the personality as a mosaic rather than a core, and the way we work with interjects and the way we work with trauma, it's also different at a very basic level. I found it necessary to start resource therapy.
Yes, because the personality theory of resource therapy really informs those 15 treatment actions. Mm-hmm. So you've got I like to think of it like a skeleton which to build on, and there's key steps that you need to take in terms of what's diagnosis. That's a different system as well, isn't it? Our diagnosis system and resource therapy is
And ego state therapists for years said you have to learn hypnosis, you have to train in ego state therapy. And I don't see any need to do that. It's always good to train in everything you can and learn more. The more you learn, the better off you are. But the actions of resource therapy create a level of focus that is all you need to access all the parts. And I think it's much more powerful in terms of creating change for traumatized parts, for eating disorders, and another difference in ego state therapy and resource therapy resource therapy has tools to respond to every psychological disorder. If it's in the DSM-5 and it's a psychological disorder, resource therapy can respond to that. A lot of ego state therapists believe it's an adjunct to a therapy they're already using. Mm-hmm. You can use techniques from resource therapy with other therapies, but it's a complete therapy itself. It's a complete theory of personality.
Yes, it's fully formed, isn't it? You can, mm-hmm. The 10-day training, in fact, gives you so much in terms of you're working with depression, with pain, somatic conditions, a lot of what we do, fear and rejection, which a lot of our clients come in with. It's an emotional therapy. And I've had a lot of clients, you know, both with psychiatrists and have seen other folks, and they've seen people don't work with emotions. Strange, isn't it?
And that's what brings people into therapy. You know, nobody comes to a therapist because of the way they think. Mm-hmm. They may come to therapy because the way they think makes them emotional. Mm-hmm. But if a person can think that they're living with people from the moon, and if they're happy, they don't come to a therapist. If they're not happy, then they'll come to a therapist. If they're upset, it all comes down to emotions. And in my training, I talk a lot about below the neck and above the neck. Mm-hmm. And these resources that fuel our issues are almost all below the neck. Mm-hmm. They're almost all emotional. They're not intellectual. Mm-hmm. And to be able to bring those emotional resources out is very important.
Yeah, to invite and awaken those states that are below deck out to mm-hmm. play and into the helm. And Faye has said it sounds like an empowering therapy for both client and the therapist. Isn't that so?
It is. It is. It makes I don't burn out. I'm old enough to burn out. But I don't burn out because it feels so good to help somebody. Mm-hmm. And you actually see movement with this. I've had a lot of trainers or people who've trained say they've worked with a client for 6 years and had very little movement. And then they did these techniques and they had immediate movement. Mm-hmm. And it really feels good to see that change happen. And that's why I want other people to use it, because I think there's art involved, and anytime there's art involved, the artist, it goes through them rather than from them. I've talked to a lot of people who've created art, and they all say I was in the groove and it was just coming through me. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where this is coming from, but I feel a responsibility myself to move it on. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I'm smart enough to come up with this, but I do think it's worth moving on. And that's what Anna and I are trying to do.
Yes, Anna, yes. I just want to, and Catherine's saying, I agree, resource therapy nourishes the counselor. Win-win. It so does, isn't it? It's like, I get energized actually in my sessions, and I deal with victims of crime, a lot of trauma and a whole bunch of mental health issues, bipolar, everything. But people come out actually kind of shocked, I think, a little bit sometimes, like, oh my God, I saw one person with many issues and he said, I feel better after the first session. And they want to come back and they'll refer more people to you, don't they?
And a traumatized state. Another difference in ego state therapy, there are some ego state therapists believe that you should ego strengthen before you go to a trauma.
And it's the same as EMDR as well.
See, to me, that is working against yourself and working against the client, because the client is holding this little child state that's upset. And if you're afraid to go there, if you're afraid to bring that child state out and help it, that says to that child state, there must be something really wrong with me. And ego strengthening is going to a different state, a different state that has more strength and ability to communicate and things like that, and holds the therapist away from where the therapist really needs to go. And when you actually go to the state that's upset, like you said before, 10 minutes, it's not upset anymore. And it's hanging on to an illusion that the past is still happening. And when it can realize it's not happening now, we can shrink that down. We can say anything we want to it. We can bring in loving, nurturing parts. Very quickly, you can move that state that was very upset to a state of comfort and safety. So that's a big difference in ego strengthening and resource therapy techniques.
And in the empowerment phase, RT actions 4, 5, 6, and 7, being able to say whatever the unmet need is as well, mm-hmm. and the relief stage where we get an internal resource that's not external. Mm-hmm. That's a huge difference. That right. One of my clients said, oh, no one can take that away from me. People leave, people die.
That's
but
right.
This is inside of me now.
Right.
Yes, yeah, amazing.
And mm-hmm. we're talking a lot about trauma, mm. but it's
not just around that.
In bridging, you bridge only to states that are baited with fear and baited with rejection. And that's two of the 8 pathologies. Mm. And so there's resource therapy views that personality can have 8 different pathologies, and the other 6 have different techniques that don't include bridging, don't include those mm-mm. empowering techniques that you mentioned, 4, 5, 6, and 7.
Yeah.
And those techniques are very powerful too.
It's catch-all, isn't it? I'll come to a couple of questions in a moment. You're going to say an example.
Oh, baited with confusion, where someone has a part that can't incorporate something that happened, and they're ruminating about it, and they can't let it go, and with very few minutes, that state can be moved from that state of confusion that might have been keeping the person up at night, might have been bothering them a lot, to almost bliss. And no bridging involved at all. It's using different actions.
It's fantastically powerful, isn't it? Especially for mm-hmm. the grief and those, mm-hmm. Something done something wrong emotions. So we've had a beautiful question from Faye, and this is for the resource therapist that can answer in the chat as well, but I'll put it to you also, Gordon. How many sessions on average does it take to work with trauma and PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder clients? Shane has said the difference between doing and being. Some therapies involve doing and being to work around the issue. Resource therapy involves resolving the issue at the fundamental being, the root cause, I'm saying that, level. So no workarounds required. We don't need the person to breathe or meditate out of it. We deal with it.
That's right.
The issue simply isn't there. I've had that. Clients, one of my clients said to me, I realized I was feeling guilty all the time by the absence of not feeling guilty in these particular situations where she'd be triggering into abandonment and lost. And what's your thoughts?
I might respond to that question. Mm. The number of sessions for trauma greatly depends on the client. I had a client who had panic attacks, and we've got a video in the training about her with her. And she had one near drowning experience that was traumatizing to her, and she didn't tell anybody about it. And she wound up having panic attacks later. After that one session with her, her panic attack stopped. The rest of her life was pretty good. But someone who's lived a life of a lot of trauma and had a lot of difficulties through childhood and through other parts of their life, that same person working with trauma might take many months.
I've found that too. I work with an adolescent referred by the mental health service, because she's being discharged at 19. And first session we did, there was panic attacks. She was having 3 a week for a week. It was a lot. One session, no more panic attacks in the last 3 weeks. But we'll be working sort of weekly or fortnight. She said, and she's far more assertive with her partner. And there's a part called matter of fact, who's able to speak up about her needs. And it's really super powerful. So she's been in that service probably for several years, but I would say I'll be working with her a little bit, but not that long.
Yeah.
Probably 1 to 2 years, because there's complex post-traumatic stress, but it won't be like weekly. It'll be like we'll move to monthly.
And the movement's a lot quicker, and you actually see movement. Yeah, if you're working with someone, and a lot of therapists work their career without doing this, but if you're working with someone with BID, multiple personality, and working through that, that takes multi-year. You know, it's you can have a lot of movement. Maybe they don't stay for the whole time, but you're actually reprogramming the brain, and that takes quite a while to get those parts remembering each other and working with the trauma that's associated with that. So it depends on the client, but it's a very rapid therapy. I think it's quicker than anything else because it goes to the issue and works directly with the issue.
I had a client like that. I worked for a couple of years with her. She had somatic complaints. She had panic attacks. She was dissociating. She had full things. She, you know, she'd been exposed to Chernobyl, war, intergenerational trauma, loads of vated states, and also hearing trauma as well, vicarious trauma. It was, you know, she was from Europe, and yeah, the shifts are amazing, really amazing and empowering. Because I remember the doctor that referred her said, "I think she's psychotic," and I wasn't sure whether to refer to you or straight to ED. But
I think those eight pathologies. Once, you know, when you learn resource therapy, you learn those eight pathologies, and you can very quickly diagnose a state into a pathology, not the client, but a state. It's unlike DSM-5 diagnoses the client into a category. Resource therapy diagnoses a state into a category. And then there are actions that are lined out, set out specifically for how to work with that pathology. And it, you know, I know when I started working as a therapist, I would sometimes have a client and the client would say something, and in my brain, I was panicking a little bit, thinking, okay, what am I going to do now? Where do I go from here? But with resource therapy, you don't do that. Once you learn those eight pathologies and the presentation of the state is very different for each of those pathologies. If someone's vated with fear, the presentation of that state is they're physically afraid.
Yep.
If they're vated with rejection, they don't feel good about themselves.
Yep, you'll see it.
If they are dissonant, which is just having their own state out, they're frustrated. And they're not emotional. They're just frustrated that they can't do any better. So you notice that frustration or that fear or that rejection or that confusion, and then you follow the sequence of actions.
It's amazing, that, isn't it? I found that too. It's because they don't teach you this in counseling or psychology classes, really, what to do with a real client. But resource therapy actions are so simply learned, and it just gives you a roadmap. But there's creativity around that, real creativity. And and it is, it's not frightening anybody. It's like, oh, I know what to do. And it helps your clients too, because we as therapists need our right part out in order to be able to work with our therapist part. Yeah. And so I'm just going to go to some of the beautiful questions and shout them out here a little bit. So Catherine's responding to how many sessions does it take on average for PTSD, not complex PTSD, as the person I'm talking about for 2 years, but 3 to 4 sessions. Faye saying thank you to Shane and Catherine. It is so useful. Catherine Hickson here is saying first session can be building rapport, working alliance, but sometimes you feel the need to go straight into the RT sequence. And that's right, because what Gordon was saying there about it would be like leaving a little baby alone in the woods. That's the picture I've got, like, you know, that's helpless and screaming in pain or agony and frightened. So you deal with that, and it's so quick, isn't it? People are just going to, so much can happen in that first session.
It is.
And Catherine's saying, it is interesting, isn't it? And thanks, Catherine. Leanne is saying, thanks, Catherine. Is that done dissociated? Leanne, do you want to say a bit more about what you're saying there? Leanne, if I can, is that you, Leanne?
Yeah. Is that okay to just unmute and talk?
Yeah, please do. Please okay. do. That's the whole idea, actually. And now, which Leanne, okay. we've got a couple on there. So just hold up your hand and show me.
Oh, I'll put my video on.
Oh, that would be helpful too.
Okay. Hang on. So I'm just wondering because I don't.
Let me find you. Where are you there? Oh, hang on. Let me change my view to that one. Leanne, is it Leanne Little?
Yes, here I am.
Beautiful. And I will. Spotlight you. There you go. We've got you.
Okay.
Hi.
Okay. I've worked a little bit with ego states just from what I read in your book. So I don't use it a lot because I don't feel confident. But the resource therapy sounds fantastic. But I'm just wondering, is the idea to get them to connect with that emotion and sort of almost abreact so that we're connected with the right part? I'm not sure if I've got that.
That's a great question. Yeah. There.
Sure. Abreaction is not a goal, but it's often along the road. An abreaction is a panic attack in therapy.
I like that.
I made that up. and if what Watkins did, he tried to get clients to abreact. And really, when a client is abreacting, they have a state out that is baited. And that's a time when you can really help that client. So if you use what Philippa was referring to as those empowerment steps, less than 10 minutes is an outside, that state will move from feeling out of control to being safe and protected and supported and nurtured.
Yep.
And so what I do when the client comes in, I say, what are you ready to change today? And they tell me, and then I vivify specific. I go to a time when that happened for them and bring that state out. Occasionally when I bring that state out, if it's, you know, a panic attack or something like that, they will abreact. And as therapists, when we know that that state is afraid of something that happened in the past, and it's not in this therapy room. They're in this nice, safe therapy room. And all our mission is to use the right steps to reveal to them that now that's in the past, that's a memory fragment. Now they're safe, that they can shrink that down to 2 centimeters tall. They can say whatever they want to it. They can put out the flame, they can whatever. By us knowing that we're dealing with a memory fragment gives us the power to speak calmly and directly to the client and let the client go through that process of less than 10 minutes. And then that's totally gone and never will come back. It's very powerful. So an abreaction is not something to be afraid of. I don't look for them. I just look for what the client wants to change.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Can I just say too, in terms of vaded, when we're talking about that, it's a specific resource therapy terminology, meaning usually vaded with emotion. Vaded is a key term.
Unwanted emotion.
Unwanted emotion. My apologies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we move that unwanted emotion during the empowerment phase, resource therapy actions 4 to 7. And shifts happen so quickly, don't they, in that phase. So, yeah, does that answer your question there?
Yes, thank you.
Brilliant. And yes, any other? So it is great. We would, yeah, that happens in the Vivify when you ask the child to talk about it. Catherine's saying Vivify specific, the action too. Vivify specifics, our action that we use all the time. It's really fun, isn't it, Gordon? And that's where we bring out the part that we want to work with, the resource state out on deck that we need to be working directly with.
It's amazing how easy it is to do.
Mm-hmm. Say some more about that, Gordon, how easy it is to do.
Well, it's when, like I said, if a student says there's another student in the room with a problem, we want to talk with that other student. And in order to do that in therapy, we need to go to that resource and bring it out to where it will talk directly with us. And to do that, we ask the client to describe when that has happened for them. In other words, when that state was out. And And as soon as they described one time that it was out, we say, just allow your eyes to close so you can focus on it. And we start talking in the present tense about what they see, what the expressions of other people are there, what they're feeling. And by talking in the present tense inside that image, inside that one specific image, their voice changes. If it's a happy time, the voice will lighten and they will become light and happy. If it's a scary time, their voice will start showing fear. And as soon as you hear that voice change, that means they have gone into that, brought that state into the conscious that you want to talk with. Then you can start addressing that state directly with one of the resource therapy actions.
Yes, it's very powerful. So, and yeah, what other questions are there? I know there's some clinical resource therapists on the call. I'd love to hear from you. We've got Gordon here. What have you guys found? What are your observations? What would you, Gordon is here to answer. Well, tell us what we want to hear. So, yeah, fantastic. Really good questions too. Just the thinking of these things. Obviously, I like to sort of say a bit of a disclaimer at this point too, can I say, because we're giving you stuff. This is just a free webinar sort of thing, series. It's not enough for you to go out and do that. I want you to remain within your clinical skill set and judgment, and trust yourself around that, and hopefully, develop your own skills. So don't work within or without your own capabilities. If you don't feel safe going and working with highly emotional clients, don't do it. Skills
and training. The one thing you shouldn't do is you shouldn't bridge before you learn those empowering steps. Because if you bring out a state that's traumatized and then you just, I don't want to talk with this and leave it, you've just re-traumatized. And we don't want to do that. But if you learn those empowering steps, expression, interject, speak, removal, and relief, in a very short period of time, you've de-traumatized. You've brought out the state that's been holding that trauma, sitting down there with it for years. And it no longer has it and no longer ever will have it. And that's de-traumatizing, and the client will feel much better after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so important.
So don't bridge until you know those other steps.
Yeah, because that's the empowerment phase, is where we actually rewire the brain. So I like that, because almost resource therapy, it can internally with neuroplasticity change these neural connections. It's fantastic like that, because we're working directly with the part, almost intergenerationally too, which is why I'm doing an intergenerational bridging workshop. But we have to have the skill set. That's why it's on option for clinical resource therapists and those who have a trauma processing background that would do bridging in their normal practice. Yeah, Gordon. And a lot of therapies sometimes have gone there and left someone hanging out there. I'm embarrassed to say I actually, years and years ago, was exposure therapy.
Other resource therapy techniques that are really simple. And, working with dissonant states is really easy and simple. And a great coaching tool. If someone has a wrong part out, the part that can't get work done, can't write a thesis, can't play a sport, how to make sure that they're able to find the very best part of them to do that, and to make sure that's in the conscious of the time they want it to be there. And that's easy to do as long as it's a dissonant state. A dissonant state is just the wrong state in the conscious. And when a dissonant state is out, the person just feels frustrated. But if it's a evaded state, you can't bring the preferred state into the conscious as long as that state's evaded. An example is a phobia. If someone is really afraid of spiders, they can't just think, oh, this is the way I'd like to treat a spider. Okay, I'll do that next time. Because as long as that baited state is there, it will come out with that fear and overpower the state that wants to come out. So if it's a baited state, you have to bridge back and resolve that emotional trauma, and then you can use Find Resource to find the best way that the client can deal with spiders or deal with whatever they want to deal with.
A helpful resource. I love that. It's very helpful to have a part that has the right skills and ability to handle the previously evaded states, situations. Just going to some of the questions. Faye has said, I imagine RT would be very powerful and efficient to clear chronic pain. And I'm fascinated too. Shane is saying, yes, there's a whole day in the clinical training dedicated exactly to working with pain, both organic and psychosomatic presentations. And I've put in both my website and Resource Therapy International where you can look it up, and I'll go over those a bit more. If you want to say a little bit, poor Leanne, you can recognize that you have a part with sore knee, but she's not right here, thankfully. Great. Gordon, you want to say a bit about working with pain and sensations, please? How resource therapy treats and works with this?
Sure. In resource therapy, we think about, for pain or somatic symptoms, you know, illness of any kind, there are pains and somatic symptoms that are organic. If a bee stings you, that's an organic pain. Mm. If you have a headache, that's a psychosomatic pain. Normally, you're tense, and the tension, or you're not breathing right, and you're getting a headache from that. So we do a determination on whether it's an organic or psychosomatic pain, and then we have different actions that we use to respond to helping somebody with the organic pain or the psychosomatic pain. If it's a psychosomatic pain, it's a pain that's being caused by a state for some reason, for a purpose. And if we, you know, if we tried to get rid of that without responding to that state, there'd be a fight on the inside, and we don't want that. We want all the states to have peace within, and every state to appreciate it, every other state, and to have an internal team that works together and that's glad that the other team members are there, because no state wants to do everything.
Mm, it's good like that, isn't it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. How people are hearing this? I'd especially like to hear from people who maybe have some background in hypnotherapy or something else and are hearing about resource therapy for the first time. What your thoughts are, what is coming to your mind. Just pop something in the chat box there. We're kind of coming, it's about 10, 20, we can go a little bit longer. I'm just putting up both the training links to the intergenerational training bridging, and I've done the Secrets to Successful Bridging program on my website, and I'm just about to put up the Resource Therapy International Clinical. And that's, here is this, yeah. And I'm just cutting and pasting. I was doing that in the background. So it's in the chat session. So you'll be able to click on those links in your browsers and we'll have a look at those again. Perhaps, yeah, so shoot me any questions in the chat. So here's the clinical. There are so many, what's happening in resource therapy, the world, yeah, it's a deeply respectful therapy that goes right to the part of the you that is in need. It's really amazing. There's a lot of information on that site there. And once you've done the training, there's training timetables too. You can also be called a clinical resource therapist after the thing. That's the intergenerational one. There's some neuroscience too. I like to give that as a potential too, if people are interested in the brain and some of the neuroscience that informs resource therapy, personality therapy, that's powerful to have in your background if you're that way inclined. So just that's resourcetherapy.com.au.
So the websites, you might want to clarify the websites. One is resourcetherapyinternational.com and one is resourcetherapy.com.
It's resourcetherapy.com. Gordon is President of Resource Therapy International. Is the secretary on hand? His lovely, amazing wife. Can she come forward, please? Yvette saying hypnosis is harder to do than RT. Yes. Where are you?
Hey, guys.
Hi. Let me find you and spotlight you. Well, Gordon can do that too. Oh, there you are. So welcome. And I'd say, Gordon, just before I introduce the amazing Anna, Gordon, how did you meet Anna, your beautiful wife and the co-founder of Resource Therapy International, who we beautifully love and respect, Gordon?
Well,
I'm going to go red.
She was, Anna healed me, actually.
You signed up for the whole journey, didn't you? Getting married, lifelong healing.
back when I was teaching ego state therapy, Anna was doing a workshop, and people were breaking up to learn, and there was an odd number, and Anna needed somebody to practice with, and so I was her client, and she healed me so well that we wound up getting married.
Wow, Anna. Indeed. Yes, so gifted therapist in resource therapy.
That's quite a reference, Gordon. Yeah.
She's a very good therapist. Mm-hmm. And she knows, as does, you know, several other people. Anna knows this inside out.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's right. So you're secretary, I'm vice president of Resource Therapy International. There's a whole committee of us. Shane, you are as well. Yeah.
Shane knows everything that Anna and I and you know too. He's very knowledgeable.
We love sharing what we know. That's why I go around the world wanting to train everywhere and doing it. So tomorrow is are you excited? Tomorrow's the clinical resource therapy online training. We've run a foundation training. It's so possible, isn't it, Anna?
It is. It's amazing. And we have 10 trainers on board, each taking the equivalent of one of the clinical resource therapy training days. So the clinical qualification in resource therapy training days. And Shane's taking one of those days. He's taking day 9, I think. And Philippa, you're taking day 10. Mm-hmm. Yep. And I think Chris is taking day 1. And someone was talking about somatic pain. Mm-hmm. Dr. Alistair Campbell was taking that day. Mm-hmm. So there's some really interesting, really well-versed clinical resource therapists, advanced resource therapists teaching this program.
It's amazing, isn't it?
A wonderful amazing. Combination. Yeah.
And I'll just say a bit on the training. So resource therapy, the full training program is 10 days in total. That you can do the 2-day foundation, but we usually run the whole clinical as the 10 days, which is the 2 days plus the 8 days, where we really dive deeper into specifically working with our clients presenting issues, depression, anxiety, panic, pain, dissociation, all those things, eating disorder and addiction. And because we're going online now in this wonderful world, which is amazing, out of all this chaos comes some love, beautiful gems. We are able to offer the clinical. We just run the foundation 2 days online. I think 2 days is maximum, but the clinical training is being rolled out in different ways now. For the Resource Therapy Institute, which is resourcetherapy.com.au, we're running the clinical 1 day a week over 8 weeks. But tomorrow you'll be able to also have the clinical, which is in little chunks as well. Tell us about that, Anna, the different training schedule here.
So as we were saying, each of the clinical qualification in resource therapy is traditionally made up of 10 days. And 60 hours. And so the way that we're running the online training, which is starting tomorrow, is we're going to roll it out in each of the clinical days. Each of those 10 days are going to be run over 4 90-minute sessions. So each trainer will take 4 90-minute sessions, and then you'll move on to the next trainer, which will be the equivalent of the next.
So it'll still be 60 hours.
Mm-mm. It'll still be 60 hours. It'll just be run over 40 sessions, 40 90-minute sessions. It'll be really comprehensive and give everybody an opportunity to really absorb the work and understand it and gain a relationship with a lot of different presenters, with teachers and trainers.
because resource therapy is a huge community now. We're worldwide and that sort of thing. We're offering this. It's amazing, actually, to have people be able to call in. We're also, yeah, so there's different, you can find training timetables out there. It isn't too late to register. There's a couple of places available. And if you can't make tomorrow, because we understand that's short notice, and it's been very popular, that program, there we'll be running again a foundation and a clinical in that other way. So whatever fits your schedule. I think there's been a lot more adaptability about that, isn't there? There's been a lot more. We've really responded well, the resource therapy community is. That's why I'm loving having these online resource therapy community seminars. It's just been amazing, amazing. So I'm also running on May 25th, the intergenerational bridging. That is for advanced clinicians who have to have a grounding in, there'll be clinical resource therapies. You can apply to that program. It's an afternoon sort of seminar. So it's short, but you will have to have a grounding in therapeutic awareness to be considered for that program. Someone is really interested, Cindy. Yeah, it's a mix around that. So we'll send you there. So thanks, Anna. That's amazing. Lovely to meet you.
Oh, I'll just say it's not run over Mondays only. I just noticed a comment. It's run three times a week, so Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays of every week.
Yeah, and if you, yeah. I've put the link in there, so you'll be able to see the schedule after the.
Yeah.
So thanks, Anna. It's lovely
Fantastic.
To
Thank
see
you.
And would everyone else have any questions about the training, or let's, you know, we've got Gordon here about the therapy before we just draw this to a close. It's been amazing. Oh. There's a little reaction button we can have down here. This is mine, you know. yay, and a big applause to everyone, because even though there's a couple of us sort of talking, I just get so much energy from people and interest. It's you can kind of feel it down the line. I don't know, what is it, Wi-Fi? No line, but there's a high. Yeah, yes, exactly. There's trainings all around that we're offering them worldwide year round in different ways. No one's going to miss out, I promise you. Isn't that right?
and people in Europe are doing training also. There's probably over 100 trainers in Europe.
Yeah. There's On Resource Therapy International, a whole directory of trainers, which of course, if you do the clinical, you can then go on and do the advanced clinical and train others and the world.
Yeah. Yeah. So, after you, I'll undo that just a bit, because a lot of people are interested. You do the 10-day training, and that allows you to call yourself a resource therapist. You know, if you're a psychologist, you're a psychologist as a resource therapist. If you're whatever, it allows you to call yourself a resource therapist. Then there's a 5-day training on top of that that allows you to become an advanced resource therapy, and it goes into working with dissociative identity disorder and different things. And then after having that, you can start training people in resource therapy. And then if you've trained at least 4 groups of at least 4 people in resource therapy, then you can start training the trainers, doing that 5-day training. Mm. So there's a ladder of learning that you can go through and become a trainer, or become a trainer of trainers in resource therapy. There's a lot to know.
Yeah, there is. And we will be running an advanced clinical. I will be running an advanced clinical a little bit later in the year. So if you feel like this is a time I want to move forward. And the beautiful thing about resource therapy too, there's refreshers. You can come and repeat for discounts, and it's just the learning journey continues. The community, I think in light of what's going on in this unsettling times in the world, we're all coming together online. It's been actually amazing, hasn't it? And yeah, mm-hmm. So is there any other questions? I'd love to do it. Some people are saying it sounds great to repeat each time you do this. It says Yvette, you pick up more. Thank you from Yvette to the gorgeous Gordon, the amazing Anna, and our hostess and hostess and wonderful wise Philippa. Thank you, Yvette. No bias there. Really love it. and Yeah, so it's a beautiful thing, a system that will fit in very well. I wonder, Gordon, I'd like to ask you perhaps in closing, and if there's no more questions, we're happy to stay on the line a little bit better. How do you see the future of resource therapy? How do you envision that, moving forward? I'd love to, you know, what's your vision for resource therapy?
It's hard to know the future, but it's like there's in Germany, they've just started an association, a resource therapy association, and in Switzerland, I've trained over 100 trainers, I've been going to a hospital in Dresden, and it's separate from the association that's in Bamberg. And training people. So my hope is that it will be taken up more and more people will do research. I wrote a book on how to do research in therapy, hoping that more resource therapists would do research. I find that it helps clients get what they want more quickly and more respectfully than any other therapy. And so, like I've said before, you know, I'm old and who knows what will happen in the future, but I certainly hope more people will take it on and keep spreading it. And there's a lot of people wanting to be therapists, and it's not a simple therapy, but it's a very effective therapy. The most effective that I've ever seen, and that's why I'm excited about it.
Thank you, Gordon. That's really brilliant. Yeah, there's so many things coming out as in there, and there's more trainers. Myself, we a lot of opportunities around the world, really, and a lot of therapists there. Beautiful therapists helping other people. Thank you, and you know, I'm myself doing little seminars, workshops based around the ideas of, you know, to introduce and highlight some of the resource therapy skills for clinical resource therapists, which is amazing. And we do the training. This year, we would have loved to have had the training in Bali at the Resource Therapy Institute, but hopefully next year. So that's a tropical retreat, isn't it? We get around the world. Thank you, Mandy. There's so much out there. And I'm probably going to run a workshop on resource therapy and post-traumatic stress disorder. You need to have a qualification in resource therapy, so come and do the training. That's the idea there. And anyone else have anything for... I'll just go and have a look at the chat here. Sorry, my eyesight's not that most brilliant. And I don't have like... Oh, there we go. So Catherine's saying, thank you so much, Gordon, Anna and Philippa. This has been a wonderful session. My mother part has surfaced, yes. And so I need to attend to my beautiful children. Thank you for being here. Keep well, everyone. That's beautiful. Shane is saying it's conversational as a consequence of the process. The client will go into a trance.
And I'll say thank you to everyone coming out on Mother's Day to learn about resource therapy. I appreciate that.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I didn't think about that. And if you want some more of these, let us know. I'm going to be hopefully offering this about once a fortnight. I love doing these and having guest speakers and talking about topics. So let us know in the chat box. So Faye from New Zealand, I'm so amazed to have New Zealand folk and American folk too. I actually have my mug from people watching the USA flag mug, which I went over there to get a couple of years ago. So I just love the international community. It's a beautiful healing community of really respectful people and therapists, isn't it? And learning people. It's wonderful.
Who is from the States? Is that Cindy?
Cindy, yeah.
What part?
Cindy, let's find you, Cindy.
Hey, hi.
Where are you? Las Vegas, huh? Thank you.
We got married in Las Vegas.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's really great you guys have that training because I have to do all my CEUs to renew my license. So I'm like, I'm going to see if I can just submit those to my board. I'm sure they'll take it.
Fantastic.
If I can get registered tomorrow, that would be great.
Yeah, there you go.
Right.
Yeah, and I'm talking to Sydney. I'm like, we'll come to Las Vegas.
Oh, I am definitely already. I want to help you to get everything set up when it's
opening back up. And we need trainers in the U.S. Also, we've got a lot of trainers in Europe and the Middle East.
Yeah, because I'm trained in EMDR, but then I learned about parts later on, and then I love hypnosis, and I really like this. Sort of feels like that kind of all three. Mm-hmm. You know, put together in a way that I really, and I like that you're saying, like, not to be afraid of app reactions. I think that's so, like, that's how I feel.
Yeah.
And they do interconnect, don't they? All those hypnosis, EMDR, and resource therapy, they just kind of fit in so wonderfully well. It's potentially, yeah, fantastic. Thank you, Cindy. Yeah. Okay. And I'm just going to go to gallery view, and I'm going to, there's, keep an eye out, Yvette's saying, on the websites for what's coming up. Make sure you sign up for the newsletter. And, you know, we're going to be doing something on resource therapy and NLP, which is a great cross-section as well. There's very exciting things. Yvette, I can't find you. I haven't seen say good day anyway. Yes, Faye, yeah. Students can join as well. We'll keep that in mind. But obviously, we'll shoot me an email. Sign up for the newsletter so you know. So we've had over 20 people on this call. It's been amazing. Parting thoughts. So thank you, Gordon, for being special guest. If there's anything in closing, anyone wants to make any comments, ask anything, I'll be looking at the chat. Send us an email. Ring us, you know, Zoom us. We can get around the world now. It's just a fantastic place, and like Gordon said, it's amazing that here we are on Sunday morning. I just think that is amazing. Beautiful, dedicated people giving their time, and it's been a real pleasure and honor to have Gordon, Anna, and all you wonderful therapists on the call here with me today as part of the Resource Therapy Institute online series, I guess I'm calling it.
Thank you for organizing it. It's much appreciated.
Oh, you're welcome. That is part of my journey. Thanks, Mandy. Thank you. Because I'm really, as a psychologist therapist, I'm a psychotherapist first and foremost. It's about helping people. That's what resource therapy does. I'll get emotional because there's a joy in relieving the burden of the past and freeing people to live their best lives. It's so powerful. That's why I never thought I'd ever be doing training people or being in front of people like this. This is a kid that ran away from school at speech time. And here I am. So maybe that's the power of resource therapy. Yeah. So thank you, everyone. I'm going to send the recording out to everyone on the call and those who aren't. So you're welcome to share that widely with your own community. So blessings to you all, and go forth and be curious and help all those beautiful people in your personal life. Happy Mother's Day. Now it's Philippa Thornton saying goodbye from the Resource Therapy Institute. Chris, you might want to say hello and goodbye as well. That's the big C. My big C, my husband. He's happy to. Do you want to just unmute yourself and say good day there, Chris, or video? He's obviously.
Yes, hi. Yes. Thank you to all. It was been great. And thank you particularly to Gordon. Fantastic. Thank you, Gordon.
Yeah, always amazing. Yeah, and we look forward to continuing your learning journey in some way with us, or just come and join us. So thank you for now. I'm going to end the meeting and send the recording. Beautiful, and thanks to everyone from all over the world, wherever you came from. Fantastic. Bye for now.
Bye-bye.